think you had a number of extras involved in your production. How many extras actually did you have involved in copying? We're talking.
Reed came up and did the extras. I guess I was kind of mentoring that, but she really did all the heavy lifting on it, and put together a pool of pretty close to 500 extras and background performers, really. And that's like a database. And then drew from that, and then these people were all photographed, and then working from those photographs to try to find the people who would look most, who would be most credibly. I see there's Tim Rainwright there, who was one of them, and part of the thing was he's got a kind of a look. Like, he doesn't really look like 2012. or 1862. Andrew's looking a little more 2012 now, but boy, when he had that beard down to about here, you know, there were moments on the set where I would turn around and there were some extras there, you know, sipping a coffee and kind of chatting and stuff. And I had these bizarre moments where I thought, wait, what century are we in anyway? You know, it was brilliant. The casting work was brilliant. Rhea has gotten a lot of kudos for her work on the extras casting. But, you know, the folks here in New Brunswick, I think there was just, I don't know, the number of skills, like we did a sheet, there'd be a sheet on each of the people, and particularly I was impressed by some of the younger people. There'd be some, you know, 13-year-old young woman, 13, 15-year-old girl, and she'd have filled out our thing, and it would be, what are her skills? Well, she did horseback riding, and then she could, I don't know, archery, and whatever, and, by the, and she'd done some theater, and milk a cow and you know, churning, and a lot of that stuff as it turned out is because there's a kind of an extended family who come through the King's Landing settlement, and some of these people would be the kids of, they were starting now at King's Landing, but that their parents had actually worked there and so forth. And so they have a wealth of not only experience, but experience, that life experience and values. And those values somehow came out on the screen. You know, we've just recently seen a kind of a cut. It's not all completely finished yet, but Ree and I were just treated to watch a bit of this thing, and it's there. You really, the looks in the eyes and everything. This isn't just a group of big city people who you've put some fake beards on and put into some old tiny clothes, and they're, you know, standing there with the sort of big city mentality and stuff, and then the camera rolls and they're supposed to suddenly go back 150 years in time. It doesn't work like that. Somehow the camera can see through that kind of stuff. So the fact that somebody can actually, although we didn't actually show them maybe, you know, churning butter or whatever, the fact that they had those skills and those values somehow or other, that came through on screen as being hugely believable. So that's another great reason. I mean, I don't know how much that's being sort of sold as being a part of the New Brunswick experience, but that's another valuable asset, because we cannot go, you know, for example, some of the places that these things, we're doing a Civil War picture that happened in upstate New York. A lot of that thing, 1862 upstate New York, some of that's still there. A lot of it's not there anymore. You know, you go back and try to film on some of the actual locations, and you're all hemmed in. You've got a Walmart over here. You've got some high wires. All these wires over here, of course, at King's Landing, that's all buried. It's 360 degree beauty. Nothing to prevent you from imagining that it's 1862. There are assets here, solid assets that can be sold as many benefits for coming to New Brunswick.